To get an impression of what the aurora truly looks like when seeing it live, real-time video is required. This is Substorm Aurora, playing back at real-time speed. It was created by slowing down time-lapse footage in post-processing and is hence not true video. Capturing real-time video of the aurora is a long-desired goal that until recently has only been possible with highly specialized and custom-built equipment. Today, a few high-end commercially available video cameras can capture decent real-time video of the aurora. However, some people will find that the aurora does not look to the naked eye as it does on video, because a camera and the human eye work differently. In both an eye and a camera, light enters through a lens and is focused on a light-sensitive surface. This surface contains millions of small individual elements, each capturing light and measuring how much light is captured. In a camera, this surface is a flat sensor, and the individual elements are called pixels. In an eye, the surface is the retina, a curved layer of tissue lining the inside of the eye, and the individual elements are called photoreceptor cells. There are two types of photoreceptor cells: cone cells and rod cells. Cone cells provide you with highly detailed color vision, but only work in well-lit conditions. Rod cells work in low light but can't see colors or fine detail. Cone cells come in three variants, and each variant is most sensitive to a different color. Likewise, common camera sensors have three variants of pixels, with different sensitivities depending on color. The three variants are labeled red, green, and blue. In both an eye and a camera, the purpose of this design is to determine the color of the incoming light by comparing how much light was captured by each of the three variants. Comparing the properties of cone cells and rod cells show how they are optimized for different tasks. Unlike cone cells, rod cells only come in one variant and therefore cannot identify color. But for every cone cell, there are about 20 rod cells. Each rod cell is more sensitive to light and amplifies the light signal more than cone cells. Rod cells also have longer integration time, meaning they collect light longer before resetting, and the signals from many rod cells are combined, further enhancing their low-light capabilities. Altogether, these properties enable rod cells to remain responsive down to extremely low light levels, long after cone cells have stopped working. Conversely, because cone cells reset faster, they are better at detecting fast motion, and because signals from cone cells are not mixed together as much, they are able to resolve details better in spite of their much lower number. Rod cells are most sensitive to light of relatively short wavelength, meaning blue and green colors. They are barely sensitive to red light, which is why you can use a red lamp in the dark without ruining your night vision. The retina has an area a little larger than that of a full-frame camera sensor. It has a blind spot with no photoreceptors where the optic nerve leaves the eye. The rest of the retina is mostly dominated by rod cells, except for a small area at the center back of the eye called the fovea. This is populated exclusively by densely packed cone cells and is responsible for our highly detailed central color vision. At low light levels, however, it is like a second blind spot due to the lack of highly sensitive rod cells, and this is why dim stars disappear when looking directly at them. The human eye is highly specialized. It is much more complex than a camera, both in terms of how the retina is designed compared to a camera sensor, and how the image data is processed. Modern cameras remain inferior in many ways, but clearly they are able to outperform the human eye in some areas. As night falls, light levels drop below the point where cone cells are effective. Gradually, our vision changes to the less detailed black and white version provided by rod cells. To be useful, the eye must keep updating the brain a number of times per second. This is unlike a camera, which may collect light for several seconds to capture a single image in full color and with far more detail than is visible to the naked eye. In photos with long exposure times, moonlit nights may look like broad daylight, but stars and aurora are only visible when it's dark, even to cameras. Because aurora is a low-light phenomenon, it is mostly seen by rod cells, which do not discern colors. Human eyes are far from identical, however, and the ability to see colors in the aurora varies significantly from person to person. To some people, the aurora looks as colorful to the naked eye as it does on camera. To others, it has little or no color most of the time, which may make the vivid colors appearing in photos seem deceptive. The brighter the aurora is, the better its colors can be seen. Cameras are better at capturing faint aurora, but during auroral substorms, the balance shifts in favor of the human eye. The aurora may fill the entire sky, becoming highly dynamic and bright enough that the true colors of the aurora become visible to all. Such displays are difficult and sometimes impossible to capture well in time-lapse, but they are thrilling to watch live, making for extraordinary and unforgettable experiences.